A lot of these experiences are sort of bringing us closer to death to give us a deeper appreciation of life. And I think that is incredibly powerful. It doesn't need science to explain that because it's almost unexplainable.
Have you ever had a panic attack since you've been doing it?
No, it's been 4.5 years. It helped me to create mental space between, okay, there's physical sensations that don't feel comfortable. There's a trigger that doesn't feel comfortable. But actually, how can I breathe right now to create that space? The physical practice of shifting my attention to my breath is almost a distraction, but then the physiological processes that are calming my nervous system are also helping to minimize the anxiety. If you can tolerate higher levels of CO2, you can breathe less, breathe calmer at higher levels of intensity. How many people do you see out on a jog along the river going,
yeah.
Why are you breathing like that? You don't need to breathe like, you can breathe so lightly, so slowly, mind calm, body calm, run for miles. The emphasis has always been on, if you need help, please reach out. I can speak from experience. When you're in that place, the last thing you're gonna do is reach out. It is so, so difficult when you are in that darkness to reach out. If you feel that you are in a solid enough place and you are worried about someone, take some of the onus on to reach in. It's washing people of responsibility. I've left my door open, but it's another thing to actually like reach out and help someone come through that door.
Jamie, welcome.
Thank you, mate. Thanks for having me.
Thank you for coming on. Before we delve in, just for anyone that's listening, in a couple of sentences, what is it you do?
It's a good question. I'm a breathwork coach, breathwork practitioner, and really all of my work spans how we can look at using our breathing to benefit our physical health, mental health, and emotional health.
Wow. I feel like a lot of that is very in at the moment, especially since probably, for me anyway, from lockdown one, we've got lockdowns, haven't we?
Yeah.
Lockdown one, I think, when we started the cold water dipping with Wim Hof and stuff, and there was a lot of breathing techniques and YouTube videos. But before we delve into that, tell me a little bit about growing up for you.
Yeah, it's an interesting one. We were just talking before we came on about therapy and, you know, how often we end up going back to growing up when we're sat in the therapist's chair. And I'd say I had a pretty traditional upbringing. So I grew up in Surrey. You've been digging me for being a posh boy.
Yeah.
Nothing wrong with that.
Yeah,
exactly. We're all different. Mm. Went to a decent school. I played a lot of sport, so I've always been pretty, I suppose, high achieving from kind of a traditional perspective. I think the thing that kind of stands out for me from my upbringing is there was always an emphasis on being polite, always kind of be nice, be polite, treat people well. And I think that's impacted me in a few different ways. I think I consider myself someone who's, you know, kind, thoughtful, compassionate, but also I think there are elements of that that have fed into some less good parts of how I interact with people in terms of being a bit of a people pleaser, being a bit too nice in certain circumstances. Yes, man. Yeah. The nice guy to almost to a fault at points. And that's something that I'm sort of unlearning over the last few years. And then I guess quite a big part of growing up for me, my parents got divorced when I was 15. And that for me was, you know, we talk about, you know, the word trauma gets thrown around a lot. But I think at that age, such a formative age, coming into late teens, sort of turning into a man, my dad leaving was a big part of where my life has gone since then and kind of my experiences with my own mental health and different bits and pieces like that. So that stands out to me as kind of a big thing in my childhood. I count myself very lucky. Like I'm very grateful to have had, you know, I have a good relationship with both my parents. I got an older sister, I got a great relationship with her. We were, you know, solid as a family. Kind of pretty standard middle class upbringing. Like didn't have to really graft too hard from I never felt unsafe from like a financial perspective. Just sort of little bits and pieces that you know, as they always do, kind of feed into how you experience your adulthood. So, it's kind of a brief interlude into my childhood.
I appreciate that. Thank you. I always like to go a little bit back, just as we were talking off mic, you only discover this really when you've been to therapy, I feel,
yeah.
or you're a bit aware, but I always find that events in our childhoods we're growing up now, I've discovered, actually trigger that drive or ambition or whatever we're trying to do for later on in life. A lot of guests I've had on that are like super high achievers, probably like yourself, have spoken about their childhood, and then there's like a pinnacle point where I think, right, that's where they're getting their drive from. So that your parents breaking up when you're 15, that must be tough, because it's, it is an age where you kind of now understand what's what. Do you, you're a high achiever before that. Did that spiral you into any different mindset at that period? Did you suddenly stop high achieving to try and get back at him, her, them? Was any of that going on in your head when you look back now? You might not have noticed it at the time.
Yeah, I think it's always nice to have the hindsight, because I don't think you ever really realize it at the time. But I think for me, two things came to mind as you're asking that. I think the first being my, I was still, you know, still high achieving kind of through my, through that period. I went massively inward. So I kind of, I'd say I was fairly, I don't know if my parents would necessarily agree, but like fairly outgoing, fairly kind of more extroverted. Still, I'd still consider myself an introvert for pretty much all of my life, but more extroverted, more comfortable socially, that kind of thing. And then after that point, definitely looking back, I was from kind of, you know, a lot of my work centers around the nervous system, and I went into the freeze mode. So shut down. I very much lost my voice. I found it very difficult to voice my opinion. And I think that had a bit of a knock-on effect in, I think when I was 17, 18, I remember, you know, parents even at school, throughout my life, it was always, yeah, my teacher saying, everything's good, I've not got a huge amount to say here. And then at one parent's evening, I remember one of my favorite teachers sort of going a little bit unintended, going a little bit off script.
Yeah.
And sort of saying, yeah, we've really, you know, noticed a bit of a drop off and you don't really seem yourself. And that to me is actually, when I look back, kind of the first moment where I'm like, that to me feels like where, you know, depression entered my life, where anxiety entered my life, where I started struggling with my mental health, sort of from 15 through to, you know, my early 20s. And I think that for me, I definitely just found it more difficult to focus, found it a little bit more difficult to engage myself, lost passion for a lot of things. I think that was something that really affected me. I lost passion for things that I loved before. But I think in terms of drive, you know, I did always, you know, my sport especially, but also academically, you know, I had a solid track record from that perspective. And I think after my parents split up, I can definitely notice a bit of a sense of, because it was ultimately my dad that left, a bit of a sense of wanting to impress dad, wanting to be good enough for dad, wanting to show him, you know, go on, love me, because I'm doing this, I'm doing this, I'm doing this. And I think, you know, ultimately that's not love if you're kind of, if it's transactional. And so I definitely, yeah, can look back and say, okay, yeah, I was pushing hard and pushing myself hard and holding myself to very high standards, and all in my own head. Like he always wanted the best for me, and he, you know, he played international sport. So he definitely had those standards for himself as well. But I think a lot of that was coming from inside of me going, okay, how can I get, because as a kid, you're going, okay, my dad's left because of me. You know, you make it about, we all make it about ourselves, right? And so there is definitely an element of going, okay, how can I win that love back? How can I make this right? How can I fix things? Which, yeah, brings its own challenges for sure.
Definitely, mate. I mean, firstly, respect to that teacher for clocking that there was a change in you, if you know what I mean, paying attention.
Yeah.
That whole like piece with your dad, are you content with that now? Are you looking back now, or where you are now with him, your relationship, are you content that you've effectively done him proud? I put that in exclamation.
It's interesting because
I only ask, sorry to butt in, because it's one of my lifelong goals, I guess. I mean, as a boy, as a guy, you want to make your father proud, I think naturally anyway, regardless of that kind of thing you went through.
For sure.
And that's all I think about. I think about what he went through to come to this country, to give me a better life, to work his ass off. And then I sort of think like, I hope he's proud. Do you know what I mean? And in a weird way.
Yeah, I think I definitely, in the last 2 years, I think, have reconciled personally a lot of how I relate to what happened with my parents, and especially my relationship with my dad. I think I subconsciously, more than consciously, had pushed, almost kept him at arm's length and said, okay, there's a bit of what felt like, and this is never about blaming him, it's just how the experience impacted me. It felt like a bit of a kind of breach of trust. And so, okay, you know, primary caregiver, dad to a son, that breach of trust hits hard, mm-hmm. or that perceived breach of trust. And so I definitely kept him sort of at arm's length. And I've really, through my own sort of healing, my own journey over the last sort of 5-6 years, really through understanding and through kind of conversation, through different sort of ways of healing, have made my peace with a lot of it. Mm-hmm. But that being said, I think there's always that element of, you know, wanting to do him proud. And he supported me, you know, pre and post divorce, financially, you know, emotionally. Like, there was more financially than emotionally, to be fair. But you know, with university and school, and I never had to, as I said at the beginning, like, there were never too many financial worries from my own perspective. I was never going, how am I going to pay for this? How am I going to pay for that? And I'll always be grateful for that. And I think I'd want to say rightly so, feel almost like I owe him to respect that and to do him proud to an extent, which is interesting because I sort of followed a very set path based on his life, because he's always worked in finance for his whole life. And I could see, looking back again, from about 15, I went from, you know, enjoying English, drama, art, to studying maths, economics, French, philosophy. I kind of veered into going, okay, how can I follow that track? And went to uni, studied economics, thought I did internships in investment banking, thought I was going to literally follow the exact same path. And I want to say, fortunately, figured out that it wasn't for me. And so actually now doing what I do, there is an element of, you know, I've made this joke in a few of my sessions in the past, say, you know, I'm a breathwork coach, practitioner, I'm a disappointment to my father. And, and I don't think he knows about that joke, and I am joking, but I think there is part of me that's going, I wonder what he thinks of what I'm doing now. Because I don't think he fully necessarily understands it, and that's totally fine, but it's probably not what he had in mind for me. But I do think deep down what he has in mind for me is he just wants me to be happy, as most parents do. So yeah.
I mean, it's a funny piece that, like, I wonder if he looks back now and he's happy. And I think about this, as I said to you, but ultimately, if we break it down without being insensitive to them, does it matter what they think in reality?
Mm.
If we go much bigger and look at our minuscule time on this earth and what we are in the timeline of how long it's been here,
mm-hmm.
you're on the planet for 60 years, providing yeah. you're not harming another human or them, does it really matter what people yeah. think? Whether they're your mum and dad, as long as you're kind of cracking on?
Yeah, I think that's really interesting. It's something that's come up for me in the last few years as well, because I'm very, very close with my mum. I am hyper aware of upsetting her as well. And so she's quite anti things like tattoos and that sort of thing. I was like 26, 27 when I got my first tattoo, and I was bricking it because I didn't want to piss her off. I didn't want to upset her because she's my mum. And, you know,
I rate that respect.
Yeah, she like really was not thrilled by that, but was okay with it because, you know, ultimately she loves me. But I do think I've certainly been a little bit, and it's almost this nice guy, people pleaser vibe that I've had kind of living within me for a while, which is it's almost an element of codependence where you're changing what you really want to do, what you say, how you act, because you're worried about upsetting someone else. And I do think, you know, as long as you're being thoughtful, leading with compassion, then you should be doing what you want to do. And yeah, kind of, it shouldn't matter what other people think of it. And especially with parents, you know, I'm very lucky to have two loving parents. Even if they're not thrilled by it, even if they don't love what you're doing, they'll make their peace with it because they care about you. And I think that's sort of where it comes down to in the end.
Yeah. And like, I respect that. And I feel the same as that. But like, ultimately, I read a passage I read these books every morning, The Daily Stoic and The Daily Laws by Robert Greene. And he wrote one I think December, the whole intro passage to December was about death and about like how in the old days, death was always around us. So you'd see someone be killed in front of you because it was a bit more barbaric, all this kind of stuff. Whereas now we're so sheltered from it. It's never spoken about. It's never seen, you know, maybe in a film, it's never, no one speaks about it. So we have this crazy fear of it.
Mm.
But actually, if you break it down, it's the only thing guaranteed. We're all going to die one day. So, and it wrote a bit about like cancer patients in there and how if someone said to you tomorrow, you found out you had cancer, how would you live? You know, and he said it's always a really interesting thing to put something like mortality into someone's sort of mindset because it changes the way they live. He said, but the crazy thing is we already all know our time is going to be up. It's not like we're all living forever and then this person gets ill and they sort of change it. And he was like, ultimately, we all pass away and no one's really remembered.
Yeah.
And, you know, we all think we're really important and what we're doing is really important. And, you know, this podcast or the fact that I've got that car or this festival or that club is so important. But in reality, in 10, 20, 30, 40, however blessed I am, when I go, there's going to be a few hours a morning, a few weeks a morning, a few months maybe. Life goes on. Time goes on. So I wholeheartedly agree with you that actually providing you're, you know, thinking of compassion, not hurting another human or the people around you, you kind of want to do what you want to do and get on with it. And it's taken me years to discover that because I'm a people pleaser. Mm. I'm a yes man. I care about the other person more than I care about myself. And it's been a hindrance to me in my life. And I've been trying to learn how to almost say no.
Yeah.
That's one of the biggest things I'm taking away from this year. I was thinking about writing in my journal the other day about like a New Year's resolution thing was the fact that knowing when to actually say no. I'm very, very bad at that.
Yeah.
I'm terrible at it.
Yeah. I think as well on that, like one something that really shifted it for me in terms of really wanting to move through a lot of the people pleasing stuff was realizing that people pleasing isn't as kind as we think it is. Mm. It's manipulative because you're trying to keep yourself in a good view from the other person. You're trying to make sure that they think you're the good guy by being disingenuous in some cases. Even if you feel like you're being genuine, if you are not being truthful because you want them to think that you're a nice guy, that's manipulative as fuck.
Yeah, like, it's
not nice. And so for me, I was like, okay, well, I want to be viewed as kind, but actually sometimes that is having the hard conversation. That is being straight up with someone about, you know, something that they've done that's offended you or hurt you, and having challenging conversations. Almost intimacy and friendship and connection is deepened by rupture and repair, mm-hmm. not by just like always operating up here and keeping the peace. I remember at school, there was three of us, two like best mates of mine, and we were a bit of a three. And looking back, it was like the two of them and sort of me on the outside. And I always used to think like, they're constantly at each other, like they're niggling at each other and they have these different opinions. I'm like, that feels wrong to me. I was scared of the conflict. And I'm sort of there just always sort of agreeing with everybody. And they became much, much, much closer than I was with either of them. And I think that to me, I'm just like, yeah, that's a really profound, powerful example of being nice. I think there's a big difference between being nice and being kind. And kindness is about compassion, even when it's about challenging conversations. Niceness is about, in some cases, being a bit false and not really honoring your own truth and your own self.
I love that.
So yeah, I think that for me was the most powerful like reframe to be like, okay, people pleasing is not something to, you know, wear as a badge of honor. It's actually pretty unhealthy in a lot of cases.
No, I agree completely. But also knowing it and applying it are two different things, right? So I read Robert Greene's 48 Laws of Power.
Mm-hmm.
Great book. And one of the laws in there was exactly almost what you've just spoken about. That kind of like people pleasing, being nice, actually using it as a power play, as a manipulative tool. So the first time I read that must have been 3 years ago. And I did the same thing you did. Fuck, I need to stop this. Like, it doesn't work. But applying it is so different because you have a long day, you have a stressful day. At the end of the day, you've got that conversation to have and you think, oh, it's human nature. I'll have it tomorrow. Yeah. I just want to sit on the sofa with some cookies and milk. And that's okay. But that tomorrow never comes, right? It's a mystical land that all like creativeness lives in that we never sort of reach.
Yeah, big time.
Talk to me a little bit about that mental health piece you said about from 15 to whatever age.
Yeah.
How dark did that get? When we're talking mental health, what was that like for you?
Yeah. So whenever I talk about my kind of journey with mental health, you know, it's an ongoing thing. that started for me at 15, and I turned 29 last week, and I'd say 15 to 25 was, you know, up and down, but that was the hardest period. And, you know, it's a 10-year period. It's quite long, a long time. Period. Mm. And the majority of that, I'd say my late teens was kind of characterized by depression, low mood. I remember being, I went to GP, and literally this was a whole different episode entirely, a different conversation entirely, but walked in, 5-minute conversation, here's a prescription for some antidepressants.
No conversation
around, like, you know, lifestyle, what's going on in your life, what's happened, you know, didn't even speak about, you know, what happened to my parents, none of that. It was just like, here you go.
How old were you when you did?
That was 17. Yeah.
So you're talking over a decade ago.
Yeah. Yeah.
So that would have been even worse than their knowledge of
big time. How to deal with that conversation around it. And I think, it's obviously changed a lot. But I remember getting that prescription. Yeah. My late teens was very much about low mood, depression, losing complete passion for anything and everything that I used to find interesting, you know, sense of humor was gone, like just miserable, just like low. And then anxiety started showing up sort of probably 18, 19 as I went to uni, started having panic attacks when I was at uni, and then that continued into my early 20s. And when I talk about this stuff, it sounds like I was sort of almost like debilitated by it, like I was kind of recluse, but I was still living my life. I, you know, worked full time. I went to uni. I played rugby at uni, all through uni. I had mates, you know, I had a social life. But then there was sort of this like hidden side, this part of me that I was ashamed of, I think, ultimately, but also very good at hiding. And it would show up in ways that people were able to not brush it off because they didn't really know, but they, you know, just thought, oh, you know, he's a bit too pissed, or he must be a bit tired, or he's just a bit socially awkward. And actually I'm there going, I need to go home and have a panic attack. Or like I remember my last... It was around the time, so I was 24, it was just before I started going to therapy for the first time. I was working full time, I was working in sales, and being sat on the toilet floor in a cubicle at work, having a panic attack, and then dusting myself off, getting back to my desk, back on the phones, back to work. And that just kept happening more and more and more, to the point where I was having near daily panic attacks. And I'd love to say, you know, I kind of picked myself up and took care of myself, got myself help, but 90% my mum going, right, if you're not going to help yourself, I'm going to ring round therapist, book you a session. Is that all right? I go, yeah, whatever.
What a legend.
And yeah, like I don't think, you know, I definitely wouldn't be in the position I am now had I not been through that experience, and had she not supported me in that way. But yeah, in terms of how dark things got, I wouldn't ever say, I think there's a difference between suicidal ideation, suicidal thinking, and being suicidal. I think I want to say, and again, this is a professional opinion, but I'd want to differentiate those two. And I'd say I've definitely in my sort of early 20s dealt with suicidal ideation. So thinking it would be much easier not to be here. Like this living no longer appeals to me. I'm done feeling like this. And I think probably the bleakest moment for me was I was dating someone, and a lot of my anxiety comes up around, or has come up in the past, around romantic relationships, sort of abandonment anxiety, that the good old stuff. And I was dating someone, and something came up, and it was late, and I was on my way home from work, and I was basically having a panic attack. And I just sort of started walking. I was in a bit of a daze, a bit of tunnel vision. I was walking and I found myself on a bridge. I just sat there and I was just crying and crying and crying. And at that point, I always come back to that. That was kind of probably, it stands out as like the darkest moment where I was probably seriously considering what life would be like if I chose to not continue. Always sort of fortunate to have come out the other side of that.
Wow. Thanks for sharing that.
Thanks, mate.
I just want to delve in a little bit to your thought there. You know, when you're sat on that bridge and you're thinking, what would life be like? Now, is that you think you're a burden on people, or is that you're in so much pain that you want to be out of the pain? Do you see what I mean?
Yeah, totally. And I think a bit of both. I think I think maybe the pain that I was looking to escape from was amplified by feeling like a burden. So almost feeling, okay, there's the pain, personal pain on its own, and then also how it affects everybody else. Mm. And I think often because it was coming up in relationships, how it affected someone that I really cared about, how it affected my parents, how it affected my family. But I think for me, and this really interesting, I've not shared this before. I think I always used to really struggle. People be like, you know, what's your 5-year plan? I couldn't look beyond 6 months because the way I've always rationalized it is I don't think I truly believe deep down that was a future. So what's the point in visualizing what that's going to look like? Wow. And so I think that for me was sort of a culmination of both sides of sort of feeling like, you know, this is so painful that I can't go around this loop. Because it wasn't always super, super low. Like it was very cyclical. But the low points just made me, you know, think, how many more times can I come to this place and come out the other side? Mm. And so that, yeah, I think the burden piece is really interesting because, you know, everyone wants to reassure you that, you know, you're not a burden, you know, it's fine. But you can sometimes just see in people's eyes, you know, it's really difficult to handle someone who is in that place. And that's the honest truth. It's not always easy to hold space for that, especially, you know, everyone's got their own shit. Mm-hmm. If you're not in a good place personally and someone's coming to you with really, really heavy stuff, it's fucking hard. Mm-hmm. It's really fucking hard. Age. So, yeah, I think probably a mix of both, but I think mainly it was just the panic attacks, especially, you know, it's deep pain and just overwhelming. And you really do feel like you're not going to come out the other side.
Yeah. Wow. Without training, it's very difficult when people do come to you with these problems. I think I've spoken about it before, maybe not on the podcast, but I recently had, not recently, maybe like a year ago, two years ago, a mental health first aid training. Because what I found and what I find even now, I'm in a Facebook group I've been added to recently with like 30,000 members in, and some lad set it up and the intention's great, but he's had no training. So actually, we all put these posts up saying, my door's open, you can come and talk to me, you can do this, you can do that, which is great. And the sentiment is good. And I guess the awareness is great. But when someone rings you at 2 a.m. going, I'm sat on the edge of a bridge crying, you got to know how to fucking handle that.
Yeah.
Because at that point, 9 out of 10 of those people, maybe 10 out of 10 that are saying my door's open, won't know how to deal with it. And what they do may be worse than actually not answering the phone in a way.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's,
yeah, I think
that's a tough one.
There's something I've thought about a lot around this, which is the, you know, whether you want to say 5 years, 10 years, whatever, the rise in the mental health conversation. Brilliant. Fantastic. Yeah. Awareness conversation. All so important. The emphasis has always been on, if you need help, please reach out. I can speak from experience. When you're in that place, the last thing you're going to do is reach out. It is so, so difficult to get yourself to a point when you are in that darkness to reach out. And so actually, I think I encourage people to reach out if they can, but actually, if you feel within yourself that you are in a solid enough place and you are worried about someone, that's not your responsibility, but take some of the onus on to reach in. Mm-hmm. It's not always about, come on, just reach out, mate. Yeah. It almost is washing people of responsibility to say, I've left my door open. But it's another thing to actually like reach out and help someone come through that door.
Sure.
And it is really challenging to know what to do in those situations because, as you said, it's, you don't want to do the wrong thing. There's a lot of fear there for sure, as there should be. But so much of this stuff, you know, we talked about podcasters and therapists before we came on. Mm-hmm. It's just asking the questions in an empathetic way and just like very much leaving it open, letting someone talk, because so much of the time, talking just can help people start to understand actually the logic behind the position they found themselves in. It's not always easy when you are that far down into the darkness to come back to the logic, mm-hmm. but you know, you just got to help people unpack and unpick things themselves sometimes.
Definitely.
Yeah.
I mean, behavioral patterns, I think are really important. And what I mean by that is I pay a lot of attention to stuff. Sometimes I might not show that I do, but I do. So if I've got, you know, if you've got a friend and you've been friends with them for 5-10 years, you roughly know what they're about, what they're into, what they're not into. And if they've got a way of doing something, you know, if I've got a friend, I'll tell you what's quite good for this example, social media, actually. If you look at someone's stories they post on Instagram, if they've got a general pattern and that pattern drastically changes one day, one night, one morning, over a period of time, and that could be from posting 10 stories a day to not posting for 2 days.
Yeah.
That's a red flag for me. When I say red flag, not in any danger, but I'd reach out to that person.
Yeah.
Everything all right, mate? You've been a bit quiet. Or if they're generally always posting positive stuff and it just gets a bit dark, as a friend, I feel like you're right. It probably is a little bit our responsibility to go, that doesn't really sit right. Like the teacher did in your teacher day,
exactly.
In your parents' evening day. That's important. Let's talk about breath work.
Let's do it.
Since that's what you do. when did you first discover breath work? And like kind of what led you on to finding it?
So it was about 4.5 years ago. And it's very much part of my attempt to help myself. So I mentioned that, you know, my mum was ultimately the push that got me into therapy. And that was fantastic. And that was a starting point for me to kind of, I guess, take a bit of ownership, but also just start gaining a little bit of awareness and understanding over, okay, why I'm feeling what I'm feeling. It's maybe even like hope, you know, it gives you an element of hope when someone's like, okay, this isn't just you, you know, you're not always going to feel like this. Like simple things like that, where, you know, when you're at that age and sort of figuring things out, it's just very helpful to have someone else's perspective, someone who knows what they're talking about. And I went on this, I got very into it. I actually, again, sort of coming back to when I was growing up, I lost my connection to and my passion for, because of my mental health, for psychology and the mind and how we think and why we think. I was always fascinated by human behavior and I just lost any interest in it. And that's now, obviously, in my early 20s, sort of started coming back as I started almost using myself as a guinea pig to go, okay, why the fuck am I feeling like this? Mm-hmm. How can I understand myself better? And so I found, you know, meditation. I found my connection back to sort of moving my body, yoga, kind of functional movement. And I was a member of a studio in Fulham near where I lived at the time. And
another posh area.
Yeah, lovely area.
Just for the record.
I live there now. The guy that ran the studio, we sort of have, I guess, a decent amount in common. He used to play professional rugby, so he did a bit better than I did. But so I sort of trusted his opinion. I trained a lot with him. And he said, oh, you know, we do breath work after. I was at a Wednesday morning class. He was like, oh, we've got breath work straight after this. Like, you should stick around for it. I think it'd be good for you. I was like, oh, sounds like a load of rubbish, mate, to be totally honest. And he sort of mentioned it a few more times. And I think at some point I was like, oh, I've not got anything on next Wednesday morning. I'll stick around for that class. And I always had an excuse. I was like, got to get to work, or I've got to do this, got to do that. And I decided to give it a go and really, never looked back. It was a case of, okay, I think the main thing, it wasn't, I'd love to be one of those people, I'm never going to be this person, but be like, first session changed my life, never looked the same again. It took me, you know, 6 months of regular practice to actually really notice a significant change. But that first session captured me and sort of captivated me in a way that nothing else had up until that point. And over probably the next year and a half, I just stuck with it, and had some genuinely life-changing experiences through it. And so that for me was, I guess, what started the path into what I'm doing now. So that was, I guess like the origin story of where it all began.
It's a funny piece, breath work, because I've had similar experiences to you as well.
Yeah.
I feel like when we went into lockdown one, the whole nation took up this thing of running 5K, cold water therapy, meditating, breath work, reading.
Yeah.
We this kind of became very, very popular, and I'm guilty for it as well. I tried all of it, journaling. I tried everything. Throw a load of shit at the wall and hope one of it sticks.
Exactly.
The cold water stuff stuck because we live by the sea, so it kind of works.
Yeah.
The running obviously stuck. The reading stuck. The journaling worked. The meditating did for a bit, and I don't do it as much. The breath work I always struggled with. bit similar to meditating, because I just couldn't, one, I thought it was a fad, if I'm being completely honest, because I didn't understand it enough. Mm-hmm. And two, I just couldn't seem to get an immediate reaction from it.
Yeah.
So the meditating was the same. So my mind is nuts. Like, it doesn't sit still. So someone telling me to sit still and concentrate on my breathing, I one breath, two breath, and then I was like, fuck's going on in that meeting today? Mm-hmm. You know, like, and I'm not finding this peace.
Yeah.
And there's a few times when I meditated, without sounding a bit weird hippie-like, that I genuinely felt like I was floating. Mm-hmm. It was unbelievable.
Yeah.
I can't seem to get to that position a lot. I've probably had it 4 times in 2 years.
Yeah.
I can't seem to, and probably because I'm not consistently doing it. Mm-hmm. Now, there was a Wim Hof breathing thing that I found on YouTube that I did for a little bit. Yeah. Two of my friends, one's Ben, one's Chris, Ben Reynolds and Chris Blimsmith, you know them. So both of these guys, Ben is really into the breath work, and Billim always talks about nose breathing. We'll touch on that in a minute. So they kind of said about it a lot. And I tried this Wim Hof one, and that was more, I always thought breath work was inhaling, but his work was more about the exhaling and holding when you've exhaled.
Yeah.
What is breath work?
Yeah, that's the best place to start, I think, because
for anyone who's listening, like, they might be like, what the hell are these talking about? What is breath work? Let's take it right back.
So I think actually, like, your explanation there of your own experience with it, for me, as a big driver for the work that I do now, demonstrate some of the issues around people's understanding of breath work. Not that you've got it grossly wrong, but actually it has come to mean, with the rise in popularity, so many different things. And so, like, you look at one end of the spectrum, you've got, you know, nasal breathing versus mouth breathing when you're exercising. Then you've got, you know, therapeutic styles of breath work where you're breathing in a certain way for an hour and people are crying and shaking and releasing, you know, working with trauma. And so those two are so drastically different, but can both be called breathwork. And so people just end up going, I don't actually feel like I know what breathwork is. Or they turn up to a session expecting that and they get this. And that's confusing. That's vague. That's not helpful for anybody. Mm-hmm. And so I really enjoy in my work almost trying to demystify and clarify what are we actually talking about. And so at a very high level, I talk about breathwork as an umbrella term that captures all of, I talk about full spectrum breathwork. So breathwork, high level, any way that we can use our breath to shift our state physically, mentally, emotionally, spiritually. That doesn't help clear anything. So I talk about this spectrum. At one end of the spectrum, you've got functional breathing, the foundations of breathing. How do you breathe day to day, moment to moment? How are you breathing right now? How do you breathe when you run? How do you breathe when you sleep? What does your breath do when you're not thinking about it? Because we know that we can breathe unconsciously, right?
Good question.
So what is your natural resting, what we like to call the baseline breath? What is your breath doing? And we can actually look at how can we help people to breathe more healthily when they aren't thinking about it? How can you retrain dysfunctional breathing patterns to be more functional, to help with physical health, mental health? You've then got sort of the middle ground, which is probably like the most popular and like the most broad in terms of appeal, which is simple breathing exercises to help shift your state, shift your nervous system in a given direction. So I always like to talk about, you can either use the breath to move out of an undesired state or into a desired state. And so the breath, kind of the underlying thing in all of breath work, is that your breath is a direct line into your nervous system that you can control. And so you can shift your nervous system state, which is body and mind. And so you have these simple exercises that people might be familiar with, things like box breathing, like simple techniques where you're just manipulating and changing inhale, holding at the top, exhale, holding at the bottom. There's only four things you can do with your breath. And so actually changing the length and, you know, nose, mouth within those parameters can achieve different changes in state. So it could be reducing anxiety, could be boosting energy. There's lots of different things that you can do. And then sort of the far end of the spectrum, when I put my own hippie hat on, which I wear quite a lot, we're looking at the therapeutic transformational styles of breath work, which is born out of, in the West at least, born out of the psychedelic 60s in the US, looking at altered states of consciousness, working with trauma, emotional release, working with the subconscious mind, and really quite deep, powerful experiences, which is where some of those life-changing experiences for me came from. And so actually we've got this incredibly broad but fascinating spectrum of, this can help you day to day, while you sleep, while you exercise at a very functional, scientific level. You've then got, okay, these simple tools, you can almost build up a toolkit of techniques that can help you in any situation. And then you've also got these standalone sort of deeper experiences that can shift quite dramatically things in your life. So yeah, that's sort of the overview of breathwork as a picture from my perspective.
Interesting. I think a lot of the general public probably struggle with it because it's something we do subconsciously and to be alive. Mm-hmm. So I'm breathing now. I have to breathe.
Yeah.
I can't not breathe. If I think of it for myself, there's your breath as in to live, mm-hmm. to breathe. There's how I should be breathing correct physiologically for my body, which I'm quite interested in. You know, how should I be breathing? Mm-hmm. And then techniques, as you said, to maybe calm me before a podcast, before a talk, if I'm feeling a bit anxious. I've definitely linked elements of my breath to some of those feelings. Mm-hmm. But is there actual science behind that?
Yeah, absolutely. So from a very, very foundational perspective, the breath is part of something called the autonomic nervous system. So autonomic meaning automatic. So everything that happens in your body without you having to think about it. So metabolism, your heart rate, your digestion, breathing, to name a few of the elements of that system. The breath is the only part of that system that you can consciously control. So it's the only part that is both unconscious and conscious, which means through consciously using your breath, you can change and shift the other parts of that system. So you could slow your heart rate by slowing your breath. And that system splits into, and again, it's broadly speaking, fight, flight, freeze, sympathetic, stress, parasympathetic, rest and digest. So you have—
I live in that fight, flight a lot.
Most of us do, right? I think as society, we are chronically overactivated. And so that's why a lot of the calming practices have become very popular, because we need it. Mm-hmm. And so whenever you're shifting, you know, up into sympathetic, into fight, flight, breathing increases, heart rate increases, everything, you know, shifts up, ready to either run, to fight, to freeze, and vice versa. If you slow the breath down, then you can start to shift into that recovery state. You get better sleep, better digestion, things like that. And so the evidence kind of scientifically from the functional breathing perspective and the nervous system perspective is very, very well established. Like there's not really any room for debate around it anymore. You know, there's very niche, nuanced, nerdy parts of it that people can debate over, but actually the sort of physiology of breathing in relation to your nervous system, in relation to your biochemistry and biomechanics of breathing, is pretty well established.
What is normal breathing? As in, how should a normal, healthy human breathe? You know, because I just when you were saying that, I'm paying attention to my breathing, and sometimes it's short, mm-hmm. it doesn't go very deep, and sometimes I'm breathing deeper. But how should I generally be breathing, or what should we look out for?
Yeah, so functional breathing, which is sort of this, or for me at least, this study of how we breathe, you know, day to day, normal breathing. The conversation kind of splits into two: you've got nose versus mouth and belly versus chest. And so a healthy, normal breath is in and out of the nose. I'm talking about at rest here. So while we're sat here, in and out of the nose, deep into the belly, so using full capacity of the respiratory system, and slow, like the slower the better. So you've got a Whoop on, I've got an Oura Ring on, that'll give you a respiratory rate, number of breaths per minute, the lower the better.
What is yours out of interest?
Mine at the moment is around 13 breaths per minute. Yeah, what's yours?
About 17 point something.
So
I even went and had a lung function test because after I got COVID in 2021, that shot up by like two, and it's never come back down.
Yeah.
It's never come back down.
Yeah.
Even when I'm at my fittest, and this is saying my Garmin saying I'm like superior and I'm a bionicle age of 20.
Yeah.
My breathing very rarely drops below 17 breaths. I mean, I don't know does that mean?
It could be a couple of things. Like usually if we're looking at kind of an elevated respiratory rate, it'd be like overactivation of a nervous system. So just sort of stress basically. And also, and this is the stuff that I've done with CBS in the past, is CO2 tolerance, so your body's natural ability to tolerate rising levels of carbon dioxide. Because if you think, again, very basically, breathing is about bringing in oxygen, getting rid of carbon dioxide. There's more to it than that. But if your body doesn't like CO2 in its system or it's hypersensitive to it, it's going to get you to breathe quicker to get rid of it quicker. And so actually, if you're sat at rest and you're breathing quicker than, you know, average, and average range for a respiratory rate is 12 to 20. So that's kind of your window of average. Mm-hmm. If you're up that higher end, it's usually stress. I'd say majority of the time stress, but also CO2 tolerance and a slight sensitivity to that. So the optimal, come back to the original question, through the nose, light, slow and deep. They talk about LSD breathing, light, slow and deep. So breathing into the belly helps to regulate the nervous system. Slow breath helps to regulate the nervous system, regulate biochemistry. Light breathing, so almost gentle, silent breathing. That is what we're looking for, is sort of healthy, normal. And usually, look at kids. It's the best place to look. Like they've had no external stimulus, no trauma, no kind of unhealthy patterns and habits that have been picked up. And they breathe big into their belly. They breathe slow. And they tend to be a bit happier as well. So.
I feel like with my breathing, if I'm not thinking about it, I'm mouth breathing into my chest. If I'm really not thinking about it, I've just been trying to concentrate then on it when you've been talking to try and see what I do. And I tend to mouth breathe. It's into my chest. It's pretty fucking shallow, if I'm honest. And then it comes out and I bring it out very quick.
Yeah.
I almost, like that Wim Hof thing anyway, that exercise almost is like a induced
hyperventilation.
Yeah, hyperventilation. That's the word I was looking for. Yeah. It's like I'm hyperventilating when I'm doing it.
Yeah.
And you talk about like altered state of mind, almost like a psychedelic-y kind of vibe. Surely that's just from having lack of oxygen to the brain because you're bloody holding your breath.
So there's a lot of the science for that end of the spectrum is something I'm really interested in, because there's not a huge amount of research that's been done. It's all been very much like anecdotal. We've seen it helps people. And like some of the older kind of master practitioners that I've been around, they're not really fussed by the science because they've seen that it works for years and that's good enough for them. Yeah. And I fully respect that. But I think for the Western world and for modern practitioners and newer practitioners, there's a real desire from the analytical mind to understand, okay, what is going on here? And these deeper practices essentially are all kind of underpinned by this cyclical connected breath, something that is usually called conscious connected breathing. It's something I teach a lot. And my kind of hypothesis that is in no way proven by science is that when we breathe in that way, we're offloading quite a lot of carbon dioxide from our system, which is absolutely fine, but we're dropping that level of carbon dioxide. And we know factually and scientifically that that draws blood flow away from the brain. So you are kind of reducing oxygen delivery to the brain, blood flow from the brain. There are theories around it reducing blood flow to specific parts of the brain. So the way I always like to explain some of the experiences that show up is very similar to something like magic mushrooms, like psilocybin, which is turns down the activity in something called the default mode network, which is the ego mind, that kind of inner rumination. And when that activity turns down, you get more activity in the subconscious mind, you get memories coming through, trauma coming through. And so some people will say, you know, it's just lack of oxygen to the brain. Other people will say, okay, there's a little bit more going on here. There are other elements and aspects as well that I think are incredibly powerful around how the nervous system holds trauma and emotional energy, and how the cyclical nature of the breath can help us actually shift some of that stagnant, stored survival stress. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I think there's just so much within it in terms of these subtle ways that we can change the breath and actually how much of an impact it can have on body and mind.
I'm super interested in that whole altered state of mind thing. Whether that be through psychedelics and psilocybin, as you said, or breath work. Mm. If anything that makes sense to me logically, I tend to believe in. Mm-hmm. I'm quite a logical thinker. If I can, you know, rationalize it in my head, I believe in it. And I think about what you said, if you cut oxygen to a certain part of your brain, you're effectively having an out-of-body experience, right? Like the just before you die, I'd imagine everyone dies from the same thing, lack of oxygen to the brain. So if we're doing that from a breathing technique, you're opening these compartments and you're having the same, I'd imagine, as a DMT kind of vibe before you come back into your body.
So it's actually something I was going to mention when you, I'm glad you brought it up, when you were talking about death earlier,
yeah,
and sort of this newfound appreciation for life that people get when they either get a terminal diagnosis or they have a near-death experience. Mm-hmm. And I'm quite a big believer, and again, this is my own sort of working theory, that a lot of these practices that we love and that people are getting really kind of into, you know, cold, I'm a big fan of like Temezcal, sweat lodges.
Yeah.
You're basically moving yourself towards death, getting into ice water. Your body's going, what are you doing here, mate?
Fucking hell.
Breath work in certain forms. And there's a really well-respected guy out in the States called Brian McKenzie, who's very much more on the scientific side of the breathwork scale, who says these, you know, deeper practices of breathwork are really simulating a near-death experience. Mm-hmm. You know, and there, we need to be very careful around the safety of that and how we work with those. But actually, yeah, a lot of these experiences are sort of bringing us closer to death to give us a deeper appreciation of life. And I think that is incredibly powerful and often doesn't need, as long as it's safe, doesn't need science to explain that, because it's almost unexplainable.
Of course.
Yeah.
Of course, completely. I mean, how often are you doing breath work a week?
So in some form, I have a daily practice. So okay. I'm working with kind of, especially in the morning, like I use first hour to 2 hours of my day to kind of set up my day, prime my day in a few different ways, be that movement, exercise, but there's always elements of breath work in that. So I take what I need. So that could be, you know, I'm feeling a bit sluggish when I wake up, I want an energizing practice, or I'm feeling pretty good, but I just want something that's going to balance me and sort of help me remain stable for the day. And I think approaching a day from like a very healthy, regulated place within your nervous system just gives you a much better chance of responding to situations in a more healthy, balanced way. The deeper practices I try and do once a week for me at the moment, just as a little bit of like a bit of a cleanse for the nervous system, a bit of a kind of clear out. I also try, that's usually at home, but then I also try kind of once a month to try and get into someone else's session, because I think there's a real power for the deeper practices of doing that in a group, like as
guided,
well.
Almost.
Guided, letting myself fully kind of let go, because there's only so much that you can let go, like only a certain extent you can let go to if you're on your own in your bedroom. So yeah, kind of allowing, you know, I've got a great network of practitioners who I know and trust, and I love getting into their spaces and letting myself kind of have my own experience, because it also rekindles my love for what I do as well. I go, Jesus Christ, like, I'm not just talking about it, I'm feeling it again. And that's really important for me.
I'd imagine it's like having a PT in a gym. We all know how to train, but sometimes you just don't want to think.
Yeah.
You just want to go and lift and someone put the weights on for you and take it off.
Exactly.
What would you say like the overarching benefit you found from breathwork?
Yeah. Yeah. For me, the one that I always come back to is from my days of anxiety and panic attacks, the thing that it gave me was a sense of autonomy and I always talk about responsibility as the ability to respond. It gave me the ability to respond to thoughts, triggers, patterns. And so anyone that's ever experienced any kind of anxiety will know that you feel a bit passive to your thoughts. Like the trigger happens, the thought comes up, and before you know it, you're anxious. And actually it helped me to create mental space between, okay, there's physical sensations that don't feel comfortable. There's a trigger that doesn't feel comfortable, but actually I can, okay, how can I breathe right now to create that space? And actually the physical practice of shifting my attention to my breath is almost a distraction, but then the physiological processes that are calming my nervous system are also helping to minimize the anxiety. And so there's a word that I love. Do you know Young Pueblo? You come across him?
Why do I know that?
He's a very, very popular sort of Instagram guy. He's an author, not an Instagram guy. Sorry, mate. He does like these beautiful quotes.
Yes, I think I have.
Like very simple, very beautifully written quotes. And I went to see him speak in London a few weeks back, and he uses this word equanimity, which is basically the ability to remain balanced and calm and present in the face of uncertainty and difficulty and challenges. And I think that for me is what an understanding and a connection to my breath has given me is equanimity. Wow. And at a deeper level, I was writing the other day about it's given me kind of a resilient and regulated nervous system, which from a physiological perspective has so many benefits. It's also given me a deep sense of self-awareness and self-connection. And so those two together have kind of allowed me to build a, you know, a thick skin without it. I always like saying, build a thick skin without letting it become a hard shell.
Yeah.
So you want to be resilient, but you don't want to be cold. And it's also allowed me to understand myself, my patterns, my behaviors, my trauma, and sort of open myself to, I guess, a fuller experience of life and like an appreciation of life that as someone who dealt with my mental health for as long as I did, I lost for a very, very long time. So yeah, it's given me a lot, but I think that just that ability to respond and that sort of resilience combined with that openness as well.
It's amazing.
It's good stuff, mate. Yeah.
Since you've started your breath work, would you say that, have you ever had a panic attack since you've been doing it?
No, it's been 4.5 years. Wow. Yeah. That I, you know, if I were a better salesman, that I'd always lead with that. Because it's, that is proof. I'm living proof.
And is that like, I'm trying to get my nut around it. Is that based on the fact that you have the tools to recognize how to deal with it before it arrives?
I want to say it's almost attacking from two sides. So I still experience anxiety. Like I'm not going to, you know, claim that I don't. Everyone does to an extent. When it comes up, I have something that I can instantly go to that I know.
Is it a breathwork routine?
Yeah. Kind of. Like even just like, okay, anxiety coming up, 2 minutes, I'm going to breathe really slowly in through my nose, really slowly out of my mouth.
What genuinely sorts it?
Yeah,
for you,
it minimizes it for sure. Okay. Like there might still be the thoughts, and I can journal about that. I can talk to someone about that. But the physiological side of it, like the physical manifestation of anxiety, which does impact the mental side of it, is just so easy. You know, 5 slow breaths is as simple as that. Like when I get a little niggle of anxiety, and then. I think from a...
I need a deep breath all the time.
A deeper level, some of those more transformational style practices were able to give me bigger shifts in mindset. Mm. So I had one, it was actually the session that made me want to train to be a practitioner. I experienced, I must've been 24, 25, I think 25 at the time. I experienced a happiness and like a euphoria and a bliss that I hadn't felt since I was a kid that I'd forgotten about. I didn't even know it was possible to feel that happy. And so coming out of that session, I have a newfound realization to say, that's possible. How do I create more of that in my life? How do I find that again? How do I reconnect to that? And without that evidence to know that that emotion existed, I would have been, you know, I still would have been in a place where I was feeling quite flat potentially. And so sort of like both ends of the spectrum, like the self-awareness, the deeper experiences combined with like the very practical day-to-day, how do I feel? How can I breathe to change that?
Amazing. So if I did a little breath work or you do a little breath work, does it up your volume of amount of air you can hold?
You can train yourself. You can train lung capacity. You can train CO2 tolerance.
Would it help with sports effectively?
Yeah. So I work with a few athletes. Like I've not done a huge amount with Chris, but like we've done little bits and pieces
because he does have,
he has a keen interest in it. He's very curious about it. So I work with a couple of other elite athletes. It's massive in combat sports, MMA, boxing,
jiu-jitsu
as well.
I've recently started jiu-jitsu.
Yeah.
It's kind of one of the things I struggle with during rolling.
Yeah. Have you read Panic? Have you read Ricks and Gracie's
book? No, it's on my shelf.
No, you have to read it. So at a very basic kind of perspective, we'll come back to this CO2 idea, right? Yeah. If you have a sensitivity to CO2, we all think that the primary stimulus to breathe, so we both hold our breath now, the primary stimulus to breathe where you get that feeling of like, I should probably take a breath, is not that you need more oxygen. It's that you want to get rid of carbon dioxide. CO2 is the trigger to breathe. So it then makes sense that if you are sensitive to CO2 in your system, you'll breathe heavier, you'll breathe faster, you'll breathe at a much higher capacity at a much lower level of intensity of exercise.
Yeah.
Yeah. Does that make sense? Yeah. Like the more you move your body, the more your muscles and your cells produce CO2. And so you have to get rid of it at some point. If you can tolerate higher levels of CO2, you can breathe less, breathe calmer at higher levels of intensity. And so for someone who's hypersensitive, they gas out so quickly because, you know, you're out. How many people do you see out on a jog along the river going,
yeah.
Why are you breathing like that? You don't need to breathe like you can breathe so lightly, so slowly, mind calm, body calm, run for miles. You know, it's oversimplification, but that's kind of where I'm going with this. And so we can train, and this is very much body and mind. I've just been doing some pool training where we're actually doing physical exercise, carrying dumbbells underwater, holding our breath. It's a lot of how the SEALs train in the US, and also pro surfers do a lot of it as well. And the purpose,
liver king.
And yes, steroid king. Yeah, steroid king. And a lot of the reason for that is, yes, physical. You're training your body to tolerate higher levels of carbon dioxide. And that is very much, it's just like resistance training for your respiratory system. But also mindset. So I was in the pool the other day, and I've done bits and pieces of this pool training in the past, but not a lot. And this was quite intensive training with someone who is an expert. And one thing he said to me changed my experience in the pool. So I did one length where doing these carries where you're basically walking with your head underwater carrying two decent weight dumbbells. I did two lengths of the pool, not an Olympic pool. imagine.
It was a jacuzzi.
Yeah, exactly. And he was like, next time, focus on almost meditating. And he said, just imagine you're going for a gentle walk in the park. I did four lengths. I doubled the time that I could hold my breath for just from a mindset shift. And actually so much of our breath hold ability, free divers will talk about this a lot. People, you know, they're holding their breath for 10 plus minutes on a single breath. It's actually training your mind to tolerate the panic and realize that you're totally fine. Your body's got enough oxygen and it can handle the CO2. Yes, there are certain things you can do in training your body to handle it, but actually it's a lot of the mental side of it. And so to come back to, you know, talk about jiu-jitsu, actually take it all the way back to kind of the nuts and bolts of breath work and how the speed of your breath, the depth of your breath influences your state of mind. If you're on the mat and you're able to maintain, actually I can breathe my breathing's good, I've got it under control, your mind is calm, your decision making's clearer, you're kind of technical, you know, you're reading people better. You're actually able to, you know, Rickson Gracie, you know, he talks about you fight the man rather than the fight. And so that I think is where, you know, this idea of equanimity comes back again. You're in the chaos, you're in the panic attack, and yet you're in control. You've got that ability to respond.
I love that.
Yeah.
I've got two things for you that come into my mind then. One was, I think you partly answered it. So I could train myself, if I'm sensitive to CO2, I could train myself to be less sensitive through breath work.
Yeah.
That's important. Now, I'm claustrophobic.
Mm-hmm.
I got bullied as a kid, got put in headlocks. So I have this fight or flight that if I'm put in a headlock, I lash out and I can't breathe and have a panic attack and I shit myself basically. And that's one of the reasons why I actually started jiu-jitsu, to try and knowledge dispels fear, right? To try and understand how to get out of it and maybe I won't panic.
Mm-hmm.
So whenever I'm folded into a funny position, if I've not had I have a month off, like I've had a month off now, and I'm actually anxious about going back because I know the first time someone sits on me, I'm effectively having a panic attack and I've got to put on a brave face there and make out I'm okay, try and meditate to stay calm or tap.
Mm-hmm.
So what I'm trying to understand is if I did a little breath work with you or with someone, with whatever, those positions when I'm folded in half, when I genuinely feel like I cannot breathe, what you're saying is I actually can breathe perfectly fine. It's in my mind, generally.
Yeah, yes and no. I'd say we're not going to do it now, even though we joked about it before. Like if we were to hold our breath right now, there would come a point, and it'd be different for both of us, where you'd get that first inkling of like, I could probably take a breath here. I quite like to take a breath. And then you get to the point where you're like, fuck,
I'm dying.
I need to take a breath here. And then maybe you push a little bit further and then you'd be like, and you'd be really quite stressed by it. You know, CO2 is actually also a physiological trigger of stress.
Mm-hmm.
the mental side of it, and it, you know, it's not something that can just shift overnight, but I think the mindset part can make a big difference quite quickly, is actually being able to say, you know, I can sit with this. It's uncomfortable, but it's not overwhelming. And you can slightly, it might be, you know, next time it's 2 seconds longer, next time it's 5 seconds longer. And it's just little bits and pieces. And then also, if you combine that with some of the physiological training, then you're going to stand a much better chance of going, you know, a minute beyond or 30 seconds beyond, whatever it might be. And so I think with something like what you're talking about, I think there's, as a very, very good starting point, you know, someone listening to this, or even for yourself, you know, people are going away from this conversation and there's just a seed that's been planted to say, okay, there's, I can think about my breathing the next time I feel like that. That to me is always the starting point, because people start coming back to their breath. They go, oh, what did that bloke say about breathing again? And you just start to connect more to it and connect more to it and connect more to it. And so whenever there's a practitioner called Johnny Miller, who I know quite well, and he always says, if X, then breathe. It's like, if I feel anxious, then how can I breathe? If I feel overstimulated, how can I breathe? And it's always just using that almost as your anchor and your reference point to return to it. Mm-hmm. And I always like to think about it, you get sort of the dual benefit of, if you start thinking about your breathing when you're anxious, you're distracting yourself from the being thing that's anxious, making you anxious. And also you're getting the physiological benefits if you know what you're doing with it. And so that to me is a really nice sort of concoction of things. But yeah, to answer your question, I think
it could help.
It could definitely help. And I think just that natural connection to it can help you go, all right, what did Jamie tell me again? And like just doing 3 breaths, 5 breaths, and in those moments where there is a lot of anxiety there, or there is a lot of CO2 there, how can I reset? How can I rebalance? At least a little bit. It might not take it away completely, but at least a little bit.
Whenever I mess about with friends about holding your breath, we're in Mallorca in the summer and we all try to hold our breath and swim around this thing in the pool. I always like, I'm trying to do it more in jiu-jitsu, but I hold my breath. I swim extremely calmly, no like sudden movements.
Yeah.
And I try and weirdly meditate so that I'm not where I am.
Yeah.
So in my head, I'm thinking, I'm not underwater holding my breath. Like you said, I'm walking along the park. I'm sat on a bench. I'm cool. I've got loads of air. I'm like trying to trick my mind.
Yeah.
And it does work.
Yeah.
And I started applying it to, so we spent ages with Claudio, my coach, where we just spent an hour with him sat on my chest so I could get used to that being uncomfortable.
Yeah.
And then what I now do is someone gets me in a position where I feel like I'm having a panic, I actually genuinely kind of close my eyes and meditate for a few seconds. Now, great at my rookie level, terrible if you're competing, because your coach is going, don't fucking stay there to get him off you. Well, I'm like, well, I can't get him off till I've recovered my breathing. Otherwise, I'm genuinely going to have a panic attack. So I take a second to breathe. So when you explain those things, and I think I subconsciously do some of that and it does help, but it's something I'm really interested in breathing. I do want to do more of it.
Definitely, mate. And I think
my life.
That was one thing I noticed in the pool work that I did this week, was all of the instruction. It's what you said. You've kind of got the natural way of thinking is actually smooth movement, slow movement. And it's the same on the mat.
Jerking.
If you panic and you're flapping around to get out of there, you're using up the oxygen. If you are holding your breath underwater and you're using up all your oxygen, then you're going to get yourself into trouble.
Yeah.
And so it's actually, there's a quote that my coach always comes back to with me. Slow is smooth and smooth is fast.
Slow, smooth, smooth is fast. Okay.
So if you're moving slowly, you're moving efficiently. You think about a boat, you're cutting through the water smoothly and efficiently rather than flapping about, flailing about. And that for me is something I always come back to, especially around this stuff. It's like, you know, you don't want him sat on your chest forever, but if it's a case of the panic comes and you take 2 breaths to actually go, I'm okay, your ability then to make the right decision is multiplied by a factor
completely.
And so that I think is a really big thing. It's not necessarily like practical, very specifically practical to say do this and it will change this, but actually just that ability to check yourself, to center yourself, to rebalance, recenter, gives you so much in every area of life, be it, you know, work, be it play, whatever it is.
No, I like that. How good are you at holding your breath?
I'm all right. I think people expect me to be a free diver. I'm not. Like, that's not been my area of focus. I sound like I'm making excuses here, right? But that's never been my kind of key area of focus.
For those of you that are only listening and not watching, there's a sand timer on the table.
There is.
And I was going to flip it over and make Jamie hold his breath and time it. But I don't know if I'm going to be that cruel today.
You can do whatever you want, mate. It's your show. It's your show.
I'll let you off. What is NSDR?
So NSDR stands for non-sleep deep rest. Basically a combination of tools and techniques that you can piece together in a few different ways, but the goal being to put you into that parasympathetic state. So relax the body, relax the mind, whilst not sending you into deep sleep. So it's almost like a quick down-regulating, calming practice for the body and the mind that we can use as a bit of a physical and a mental reset.
How long is that? Like, what, 15 minutes, 10 minutes?
I've actually released one yesterday that was 10 minutes, just as a recording. You do 30, do 45.
Are these designed for like high-performing city workers that get a lunch break and are stressed to fuck and just want 10 minutes to switch off and reset?
Anybody could benefit, to be honest, mate. I think, you know, we were talking a bit earlier about, you know, everyone's a bit overstressed, you know, whether we realize it or not. I think the way we live our lives, the way society is constructed is at the moment, and everything around it leads naturally to a state of stress. You know, we're highly stimulated from all angles.
Yeah.
And so we could all benefit from, like, I try and do a practice like that, you know, 10 minutes once or twice a day to really just keep myself in a regulated sort of balanced state.
I hear you. We spoke about CBS earlier. Now, this guy tapes his fucking mouth when he sleeps. Yeah. He's a weapon.
Good lad.
And he tells me to. Now, my missus moans at me, right? Because I've got an issue with my nose.
Yeah.
I need an operation on my nose.
Yeah.
I've been putting off for about 4 or 5 years, and it's become more of a problem since I started jiu-jitsu. Because sometimes your mouth's fully blocked and you have to breathe through your nose. So if you can hear that, it's like this middle part of my nose, I don't know what it's called, it's basically collapsed.
Yeah.
So one side is completely blocked and the other side struggles to breathe. Mm-hmm. So I need to almost pull my nose out like that, and then I can breathe.
Yeah.
Now, my missus, whenever I got my headphones on, we're on the plane the other day, or I'm just sat on the sofa really intrigued in a film or something, she's like, fucking, what are you breathing like that for? But I said, I'm not breathing any different to you.
Yeah.
It's just blocked. So I said to Billum, I can't physically tape my mouth and sleep, mate. I honestly will die because I can't, I feel like I can't get the air in. Did a bit of research online, and there was some people claiming that if you keep breathing through your nose shape will change so you can breathe better. But I went to see a private doctor and he was like, this isn't one of those times, if you know what I mean, you need an operation. So how important is nose versus mouth breathing? You know, if I live all my life, is the reason for some of my panicking and some of my breathing generally being shit because I can't breathe properly from my nose?
It's a little bit chicken and egg. Like, quite often, so especially the conversation around CO2, CO2 can trigger anxiety. Anxiety can trigger sensitivity to CO2. And so it's almost like, where does it start? And it doesn't really matter. You can address both. I had about 2.5 years of chronic sinusitis, so nasal congestion, blocked sinuses. So I was not really able to breathe through my nose. I had a deviated septum.
That's it. Yeah, that's the word he used.
Yeah.
And so, that's why I went in. I thought I had a sinus. My mum had it. I thought I had a sinus issue. And he said, no, your sinuses are fine. It's deviated septum.
Yeah. So the deviated septum just will mean exactly as you've said, kind of difficulties with the nasal passages and air getting through that. So the reason, I guess, the differentiators between nasal and mouth breathing, I take my mouth shut when I sleep as well. I've done for 3 years.
Wow.
Really don't like it when I don't. I had a night away the other night where I forgot my tape. I take it away with me if I, you know,
not, I was about kinky, to say.
If I, yeah, yeah. Depends what you're into. Yeah. I just recently started seeing someone and they were like, dude, every night. I was like, yeah, even if you got people around. I was like, yeah. 100%.
No kissing in the middle of the night then.
That's a get away from it. I'm trying to sleep. I think the differences between nose and mouth breathing. So very basic level, nose, there's this kind of saying that does the rounds in the breathwork space, which is noses are for breathing, mouths are for eating. Just your nose is designed to breathe. You know, the smaller passages, so you're breathing less, which is good, and it's regulating the breath. The hairs and the way in which the inside of the nose is set up filters, you know, particles that we don't want to reach the lungs, also like warms and humidifies the air. So the nose is preparing the air to be received by your lungs in the best possible state. Wow. It's kind of the basics of it. Mouth breathing, you know, I remember when I was at school, mouth breather was an insult. People were mugging you off if they called you a mouth breather. Maybe that's just in Surrey. But
that's a mouth breather, insult.
Yeah, mouth breather implied, like back way back in the day, people, I didn't understand it at the time, but mouth breather implies stupidity. If you're getting called a mouth breather, someone thinks you're a bit thick. The reason for that is that when you mouth breathe, essentially mouth breathing leads to over breathing. And over breathing is just breathing more than your body needs to. If you're doing that, you're getting rid of more CO2 than your body needs to. If you're getting rid of more CO2 than your body needs to, you're reducing blood flow to the brain. So your cognitive function, your memory, your clarity of thought is impaired by mouth breathing. And so that's kind of the nuts and bolts of the why. Mouth breathing is also, I think the last study showed, you lose 42% more water mouth breathing than nasal breathing. So you get dehydrated.
Oh, so horrendously. I wake up in the middle of the night like a desert. Like,
yeah. So because of your deviated septum,
because I can't
breathe through your mouth. And so you'll have, you know, that dehydration, dry mouth, brain fog, fatigue, potentially, like all of these. I used to have it as well, because with the sinus issues, I was breathing through my mouth. And I genuinely believe my cognitive function post that operation, and since I've been mouth taping, and also since I've been getting into breath work, has gone way up. Like just the clarity of thought and my ability to just use my brain properly. So that is why mouth taping is encouraged, because obviously during the day, you can think about how you breathe. You can choose to breathe through your nose if you have the ability, the physical ability to. But at night, you don't have that choice. Mm. And so if you're spending 16 hours of the day thinking about how you're breathing and then going to bed for 8 hours and breathing through your mouth and breathing real fast, real heavy, whatever it might be, then you'll be losing a lot of the benefits that you're building during the day. And also if you, and this was where I wanted to get to for you personally, was if you breathe through your mouth during at night and you kind of are releasing a lot of that CO2, that is going to have an impact on your body's sensitivity to it. Because if you're getting rid of a lot of it, it doesn't like having it in there. And so during the day, you have a higher sensitivity to it. And as well, the wearables like the Whoop will measure your respiratory rate at night, because it's easiest to measure like a regular respiratory rate, because it fluctuates so much during the day. And when you breathe through your mouth, you typically breathe quicker. Like I actually noticed the other night when I didn't have the tape, I woke up in the morning, it's like 14.8. Last night with the tape, 13.1. And so like it's real tangible difference.
It's interesting you say that, because the nights that I get a good night's sleep where it's not disturbed, I'm not up for a wee, and I've slept all the way through, which is quite rare for me, my breath is very low on my Whoop for me. It's nearly one breath per thing less. Mm-hmm. And I wake up with no gammy mouth. So, and those nights, if I'm thinking about it now in hindsight, I'm probably nose breathing. Because I don't, otherwise I generally have really broken sleep.
Yeah.
Because I get such a vicious cycle, right? I have dry mouth, I get up, I have water, then I go
to the loo.
In an hour I need to go to the loo, and that's like two or three times in a night.
Yeah.
And your sleep's ruined, and we know how important sleep is.
Yeah.
So you've had the op then?
I had an op, yeah. So
and did they redo
they
all
did
of
the
that?
Septum, cleared out my sinuses, and then I was actually able to tape my mouth. And because I
can you notice it? Because he's saying, the doctor's saying he can guarantee me 80% better than I am now.
That's I take those odds, mate.
Put the camera up and had a look at both.
Yeah.
It's like 6 weeks off any training, like can't even run.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's 3 months off jits or any combat sport. So I just like, when's the right time to do that?
I think, you know, there's never a right time for this stuff, is there? Like it's just, there's
I do want to do it.
There's always a sacrifice.
Kill myself early. As in breathing and sleep, the things I've been looking into quite a lot recently, and, you know, mortality rates and illnesses later on down the line,
yeah,
are definitely linked to both of those things.
For sure. And like there's even, especially in the world of dentistry, where they're looking at teeth formation and jaw shape and things like that, especially in children, they've noticed significant differences in how jaw develops and teeth develops for kids who are mouth breathers versus nose breathers.
Wow.
And like you look at, they've looked at like tribal cultures where they just have this innate understanding of the breath. They all have these perfectly, no, they don't have dentists, but they have perfectly straight teeth, thick jaws, defined jaws. And people are going, why? It's because they know how to breathe. It's because like have you read James Nestor's book?
No.
It's called Breath.
I love that.
Yeah. And he actually—
there's so many books to read.
So many, there's too many. I saw a mate of mine who's actually written a book on breathwork for breakfast a couple of months ago. And he goes, they asked you to write a book yet? I was like, not yet. He was like, it's only a matter of time. I was like, okay. But in that book, James Nestor does an experiment on himself where he plugs his nose like permanently for 2 weeks and tracks all of his biomarkers. And like, honestly, so the week after the operation, your nose is quite blocked because they like splint it to keep it straight.
Yeah.
One of the worst weeks of my life. It's brutal. When you can't breathe through your nose at all, savage.
I panic like that anyway. You know when you've got a cold and your nose is blocked?
Yeah.
I have like a bit of panic attack then,
yeah,
as well.
Yeah.
You can't even swallow properly without your nose taking air in.
Yeah. It's really, really tough. But I definitely, from my own experience, definitely worth it in terms of the benefit from it. Yeah.
Do you think we should teach breath work in schools? Or eventually they will, do you reckon? When it's a bit more sort of,
I think so. I think there are people I know, organisations as well that I have had some kind of contact with who are looking at how you can bring this into schools. I've had teachers and parents who have approached me about, you know, how can we actually just bring the basics? It doesn't. Mm. I'm not talking about the psychedelic experiences and the emotional release. Mm. It's not necessary. But actually, if you can learn the foundations as a, you know, a 10-year-old as to when you feel a bit off, take 5 deep breaths in through your nose, out of your nose, and notice how you feel. If you plant that seed at that age, that kid is going to be Ricks and Gracie. That kid's going to be so dialed in, so tuned into their emotions, so tuned into their nervous system state, that the likelihood of them experiencing severe anxiety and challenges around that is going to be, I don't even know what the stats would be, but diminished by so, so much. And so, yeah, I'm a huge believer. Like my nieces, 2.5, so I've not quite got it started yet, but I'll definitely be, you know, in a gentle way, kind of just introducing these topics to her, planting the seed. Because if you can learn to regulate your emotional state, your mental state, your physical state as a youngster, then yeah, you'll be a force to be reckoned with in my book.
That really excites me, because I think of me being that age and what, how much easier life might have been, or how I might have thought differently or acted differently. Mm. Should I have known all this kind of stuff?
Yeah.
But I think the whole education system is an overhaul.
Yeah.
Anyway. Not just from breath work.
Exactly. Yeah.
It's much, much deeper than that.
Yeah.
What's next for you, mate?
Very good question, mate. I think things that are on the, you know, it's that time of year, December now. So I think I'm very much thinking about next year. For me, my love within this work is bringing people together in community. So retreats, I've got 4 of my own retreats next year. And
where are they?
Cornwall and then Portugal.
And what's I was going to ask you about your events. Actually, I forgot. Yeah. Those retreats and events you do, in-person ones, what does that consist of? Like if I came along, what is it?
Usually if I'm doing like a standalone event, like I do a monthly workshop in London, and that is the deeper end of the spectrum. Mm-hmm. So I'm getting people together to have an experience. It's much more experiential. Usually 2 hours, breath work, but also like connection. So there's a lot of sharing, there's a lot of talking. Like it's quite confronting and challenging if people are new to it, but it's very much about how do we get people together. The thing that I love about breath work in a group setting is I always say the most powerful healing tools are ones that you can do on your own, but you can also do with other people. Because if you can get your own healing whilst also connecting to other people who are also doing their own healing, that lifts society for me. That's like big scale change. Mm. As to how the world can become a better place, like shared vulnerability. So that is sort of typically what it looks like. My retreats are sort of an extended version of that. So multiple sessions, but also you know, other activities around that. I love integrating things like cold water, sauna. I'm a big, you know, user and advocate of hot and cold exposure therapy.
That sounds like a bit of me, that retreat.
Yeah. It's
how long is it? How many days?
Cornwall, I do 4 days. Portugal, I do a week.
You do a week in Portugal?
Yeah.
Any psychedelics there?
I was going to come on to that. So I'm also...
I've got friends that go to Portugal for psilocybin retreats.
Yeah. So I've kind of...
Teamed up?
Teamed up in a certain way. Like I'm a big advocate, I guess mainly... sort of nerd in a way of like the crossover. I've had some conversations with the team at Imperial College in the psychedelic research lab there around, because they're fascinated by breathwork because it's a non-psychedelic, non-substance route to potentially healing altered states. And so I'm looking into more of those conversations as to how we can bring that work together, because I do think they both have huge potential alongside each other. My retreat in Portugal is non-psychedelic in terms of what we bring into it. But there's a lot of breathwork and a lot to be got from it. In terms of what's coming next,
not a book.
Probably more likely to be an app before a book.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I'm sort of looking at that in the early stages of looking at that. And then just continuing to sort of build and bring more people into it as well. You know, I'm aware that I'm only going to be able to take it so far on my own. So bringing other practitioners in, mm-hmm. building out a bit of a team, and really driving that conversation forward is breath. Breathwork really is a vehicle or like a centerpiece for bringing people together to do their own healing, learn about themselves, basically go on the sort of journey that I've found myself going on over the last 5 or so years. I'm also... we're looking to open a space in London at some point that's going to integrate heat, ice, breathwork, movement, a lot of the stuff that actually, you know, started me on this path. So, I was in the sea this morning down here.
It was cold
this morning.
It's freezing at the moment. Yeah.
But yeah, I think for me, I'm always, you know, I talked a bit earlier about never quite having that ability to look into the future because I didn't think there would be one, but you know, I'm pretty clear on my vision. And we talked in passing a bit about legacy and what you want to leave behind. And my intention with this work is just to positively impact as many people as I can. Mm-hmm. And anything beyond that's a bonus. And how I do that, I'm sure will change. But breathwork is the thing for now. And it will definitely be the thing for a good while. But I'm excited to see what comes next. I think I constantly am in balance and almost not fighting, but seeking to balance the part of myself that wants to take over the world and the part of myself that wants to live in the forest and never speak to anybody again. And so it's like the peace versus it's like the breathwork guy that people expect, the meditator, versus the entrepreneur. Mm-hmm. And I am both, and I'm happy to be both, but sometimes they butt heads. So I think, you know, I'm not even 30 yet. So I'm foot to the floor in a balanced way. Like I never want to go back to the stress that I've felt in the past. But yeah, building from a place of peace, from a place of balance, with a view to probably eventually, I'd love to have my own retreat space, live kind of a little bit more off grid, slow things down. Have a family, all of that good stuff.
Love it, yeah. Mate. Love it. Sounds super exciting.
Thanks, man.
Super exciting. Where can people find you?
Yeah, best place to find me. I'm most active on Instagram. Mm-hmm. So it's @the_breath_space. Had my first fake account pop up the other day.
Oi,
so
oi.
Yeah, you know you've made it when you've got a fake account. Thebreathspace.co.uk is the website. All of my events, all of my retreats go up on there. I'm launching a podcast in the new year.
Nice.
I used to have one that was all about men's mental health. That was called Man Down. But I'm with a friend of mine who actually I was with down here over the last couple of days. We're launching a podcast in the new year that again is sort of about, I think, like healing mental and emotional mm-hmm. well-being, mm-hmm. sort of through the lens of being a man, but looking at topics that maybe we weren't exposed to as young men that we feel like we need to educate ourselves more on. So yeah, that'll be a part of next year. I always love having interesting conversations around this kind of stuff. So yeah, that'll be out in the new year. But yeah, if people do want to find me, the breath space is the place to go.
Mate, sounds awesome. I'm quite excited for that podcast as well.
Thanks, mate. Yeah, I'm looking forward to it.
Mate, super interesting to have you on. Thank you. You're doing some amazing stuff. Thanks, man. For some amazing shit, like bunch of good stuff. So thank you, mate. People follow it, and I'm going to book it myself, I think, to that retreat.
For sure.
Probably, when's the Cornwall one?
April.
And the Portugal one?
End of August.
Cool. I'm 100%. We need to do some bits.
For sure, mate. Absolutely.
We need to do some bits. Thanks for coming on.
Thanks for having me.
Appreciate it.
Pleasure.
Thank you.